Morning, everyone. Thanks for joining this talk. It will be about transactional updates again, like several years ago already. My name is Ignaz Forster. I'm in the Future Technologies team, which Thorsten, who just had the talk, is the manager of. And we have quite some topics today. You don't have to remember that. There are captions. Before I start, it will be about transactional updates, which is our system, our update system for our read-only root file system distributions, which are SLMicro 5.x, SLMicro 6.0, and our OpenSUSE distributions, LeapMicro, and of course OpenSUSE MicroS, which is based on Tumbleweed. And my initial question would be, who of you has used any of those distributions or had to use one of those distributions already? Okay, a few, but it seems some of you don't really know what I'll be talking about, so let me just get everyone on the same page. As I said, transactional update is the update mechanism for read-only distributions, which is usually you are using super for updating a conventional distribution. If the file system is read-only, you obviously can't do that. To do that, nevertheless, transactional update was invented. It will do a few things. First of all, it will just create a new snapshot. You know, our default file system is BTRFS, which is using a snapshotting mechanism. If you want to update the distribution, we are creating a new snapshot. Doing so, we are using a tool called Snapper. Within that new snapshot, we will call just a regular super update or whatever else we want to change in the root file system. Then we will set that snapshot as the new default snapshot, and a reboot will activate that new system. So if we are calling about a transactional update or an atomic update, the reboot is the actual atomic or transactional part which will boot into the new system. The huge advantage is the update itself, whatever may be happening there, won't influence the currently running system. So you're always safe if the update fails or scripts you are executing yourself should fail or whatever, then the reboot, the new snapshot just won't be activated and you can just pretend nothing ever happened. And yeah, that's an additional layer of safety to protect the system. One of the advantages why we are using RPM-based updates is that you will just keep your existing state, your system configuration, all your files in the var directory, databases or whatever you store in there. And we have support for multiple snapshots. If you compare that to other distributions, read-only distributions, you usually have an A-B partitioning mechanism. So if one partition breaks, you just have one other to save yourself from. The goal of all those systems is that you have a self-maintaining system. Usually you just install it and it will just keep updating itself. You don't have to really care about it anymore. That's the ideal. So I just said we need a reboot to activate the new system, and that was a complaint a lot of people often had. With SLMicro, sorry, SLMicro 6.0. I'll change that afterwards. We have a new mechanism called apply. What will that do? It will just mount the new system into the existing running system. So the update itself will still run in the new snapshot, but that snapshot will be over-mounted on top of the currently running system. So you may see problems already, but it has the huge advantage. You can just install, for example, a new package and use it immediately in your currently running system. That may be of use for some, but yeah, let's have a look at the caveats. First of all, it's just made possible by doing the user merge. If you remember, we had that user merge project, I think, 2 years ago or so, finally done. Previously, we had user bin, user sbin, bin, sbin, and several other directories. Now everything is merged under user. So all relevant parts of the system are actually contained in the user directory, with the only major exception being the etc directory. Everything else is variable data, except for the boot directory, but that's another exception. So it actually works to just overmount user, and you actually see the new system. So what is actually done here? As I said, we will overmount the user directory and, of course, also the etc directory. For those who haven't been using a transaction system yet, of course, also in a transaction system, you have to have some writable directories, otherwise you couldn't store anything, obviously. Etc is one of those writable directories. Var is the other one, which is very important. exactly. The etc directory will use overlays. I'll have another topic about that later. And if I mount those two directories, of course, there's a small chance that an application, which is still running in the background, may see a timely difference. It may use already the new data from the overmounted user, but not yet the data from the overmounted etc. So it's not really supposed to be used in production. Let's say it that way. It's just mainly for your testing purposes, so that you don't have to reboot all the time. Another caveat is, like in a transactional update itself, of course it won't restart any services, because that obviously would influence the currently running system. So it will move into that new system, but yeah, it will just keep running the services that existed, even if the package had a postinst script or whatever that would have restarted the service. Also the same as during a regular transactional update, because it is a regular transactional update, we still don't have any var directory in the transactional update environment. So the update itself, if it needs to do some post installation scripts, let's say updating a database scheme to another one, that will horribly fail, because var is not available, so it won't see your production data. So again, the recommendation, like in the previous talks, you have to do that during boot, but even that won't help in this case if you use apply, because you don't reboot. So that's, as I said, a tool to help you debug or do quick development if you're new to that system. But please don't use it in production. I mean, I do, but you should know what you're doing if you do so. There are only a few things that actually do get executed, which is a systemctl daemon re-exec, because, of course, systemd itself can be updated. So yeah, it has to be a daemon re-exec. And of course, you want to see new services. Otherwise, it would be quite pointless. Directories which are created in var, we have a service for that during initial boot, will also be created. And systemd temp files will run with systemd temp files create. So you get some support for the system, but as I said, no scripts in a more important way. So you see that this is a bit controversial, because it basically circumvents all the transactional part of a transactional system. It's not that transactional anymore, because you don't have that dedicated switch. You have some kind of mishmash. And that's why it's not loved by everyone. As I said, it was a request that people wanted to be able to use a system without having to constantly reboot. If we had to have a look back again at our principles, what defines a transactional system? The same old definition, a transactional system is atomic, so the update does not influence the currently, is either fully applied or not applied at all, which is still guaranteed, except if you get into that kind of mishmash. And it does not influence the currently running system, so you can always roll back to a previous state, which you know has been working, and a failed update can be discarded, so you are back at the previous condition even after reboot. We have a tool called Health Checker, where you can also plug in your own extensions if you know that service has to be working. So if Health Checker doesn't say everything is healthy, then it will also just automatically roll back to the previous state. So, next topic. Thorsten was just talking about soft reboots from a new feature introduced by Systemd. That sounds like an amazing idea, because that's another way to decrease the downtime of the systems caused by the reboot. And that's why I implemented it into a transactional update. It caused a lot of headache, because basically the idea is amazing, the implementation just seems to be lacking a bit. First of all, the soft reboot support was introduced in Systemd 254, but then in Systemd 255, behavior was changed again. Namely, even if you type systemctl reboot, which previously meant you do a full reboot, you may also get a soft reboot or a kexec reboot, even if you don't type that, which is a bit of a problem, because that required that the transaction update implementation that I had done previously would not, if I put files in the correct places to prepare the system for a soft reboot or a kexec reboot, you still couldn't say what reboot you actually want. Okay, you can set environment variables. It's possible to circumvent that. But yeah, a user probably doesn't know that. So we wanted to keep that easy. So what we basically did was we outsourced everything into a systemd service, which will just be triggered whenever a soft reboot is triggered by systemctl. And that one will remount everything which is required into the correct places. That is important again, because on a transactional system, I said it already, we have a dedicated var and etc mount. If you do a soft reboot, you don't have any init ID anymore, which would actually mount that before, so we have to prepare it ourselves. There are additional bugs in there, so you can't mount, so you can't just prepare a directory. You can just mount a directory so that it would actually switch into the mount. So unfortunately, it took quite some time until it was implemented correctly now. But if you want to try that on a non-production system, I'm really interested to hear your results. It should be working reliably now. As I said, it took quite some time. And systemd, a transactional update has support for several of possible options. First of all, if transactional update itself doesn't require a hard reboot, it will tell in the file run reboot needed appropriately. But we also have the SIP boot plugin. That's a plugin for Zipper, which will detect which packages actually were installed and whether those require a reboot or not. It was implemented by Shubi. It's not part of Zipper itself. It's a separate plugin. But if that one is installed, then you will get that auto detection and only get the reboot level you really need, the minimally required one. As I said, I don't trust that anymore too much. I want to test it for one release before I finally make that default. So if you want to use it now, you have to enable both the soft reboot and the kexec reboot in the tukitconf configuration file. Yeah, next topic. In the past, we had, if transactional update was failing, you as an administrator probably didn't really notice it, except when you were watching systemd services already. If you didn't do that, your system would never be updated, and yeah, chances are you never noticed, which is especially bad for security updates. So now we have a new service called systemd status mail. It's a generic package which can be configured to just send you an email whenever any service fails. By default, transactional update is pre-configured because that was the original requirement. But you can enter any service you want there if you want to get an email notification. The only problem is email notifications are quite hard nowadays because you have to configure quite a lot of things if you want to actually get emails. Ideally, your local sendmail instance will just send it to you, but that's a dream which is fulfilled quite rarely. So we have a new interface for that, and judging from the number of input fields you can see already, you may not require all of those. Ideally, you'll only need the first two. In practice, you will usually need more of them. But if it's configured correctly, you can get email notifications of failed services. Let me just go back once. What you just saw was the configuration GUI of choose first boot. It's not enabled by default yet either. I was hinted about that yesterday. I thought it was active already. If you install the package systemd status mail, then you will get the choose first boot wizard. Otherwise, you have to configure it yourself in etc default system status mail. Yeah. As I said, it's a generic package. You can add any service. So that's a cool feature, I think. We had that already. Other news, if you are interested in using the API or are already an active user of the Dbus service, all of the functionality of a transactional update can be triggered via API and Dbus. You can also call rollback and delete now via API and Dbus. What else? Let me just read my own news. Ah, another interesting feature. The implementation of how to create snapshots was currently a mixture of both snapper and btrfs commands. Snapper just got a new feature to support bcachefs. So if anybody of you is really experimental, you may try to use a bcachefs system now. If you set it up the same way as a btrfs system, it probably won't work as expected, but it may serve as an inspiration, because now transactional update is using snapper only, not using btrfs commands directly anymore. And of course, we just heard it, Ludwig implemented systemd boot support, and transactional update was fixed to not interfere there. It doesn't systemd boot directly yet. That's still to be done. So, last point, unfortunately, I put that into the description of the talk, etc overlays. It's not ready yet. You may remember those, if you've been using the system already, those overly lengthy lower dir parts, just a second, yeah, I have a mouse cursor, here, that setting was overly long in the past. We shortened that significantly already, but it's still difficult to detect what exactly is happening here. Especially, do you notice the most important part? It's that one, the sysroot etc directory, because that's the base. Everything else are layers on top of that. Unfortunately, that sysroot etc directory is the state of the system at snapshot level 11. If you're having a look at the first line, we are currently in snapshot 13, so that's everything but intuitive. If you want to get the current state of, or the correct state of etc, you have to reassemble all of those parts to get the correct state of the directory, and that's why it's why we want to rework that. Unfortunately, as I said, it's not ready yet. The current design had a lot of advantages, mostly because we are using OverlayFS for everything. We just have to sync between different directories. The disadvantage is, yeah, that the configuration is quite complex, and we had several services meanwhile that had to reassemble all of that themselves to get the etc contents, and yeah, that was overly complex. All of those problems are introduced at all because we want to preserve changes done to etc after the actual snapshot was taken. So let's assume you update your system, then the system keeps running for another 2 hours, and your configuration management tool, for example, changes a lot of files in the background. Then you want to preserve those changes also after the reboot. So that's why that layering was introduced in the first place. If we wanted to change that, we'd have to either get rid of that requirement completely, or, as I said, I'm currently testing a few of those options. It's a bit outdated already. The iNotify thing doesn't work as expected. That's something for the future, but expect changes here soon. So finally, in the end, we may be able to have an etc-less system, or at least an etc-less SLI microsystem, so you can just delete your etc contents, and you have a reset of your system, basically. That's one of the overarching goals, which may be achievable in the long term. I see I'm running out of time, so let's open a round for questions.
In the context of the soft reboot, you mentioned the ZipBoot plugin. Is there any action item for any elapsed package maintainers in order to force a hard reboot?
For the package maintainers, no. What I did now, transactional update doesn't change the system itself anymore for soft reboots. Mm-hmm. It will leave all the decision to be executed at reboot time, so only after the user put something in. Then the decision is taken how the what may have to be mounted afterwards. So nothing has to be done.
So how does the plugin determine whether a hard reboot may be necessary?
Because you type in systemctl reboot, mm-hmm. and because of that, the service will not be triggered. It's a dependency on systemctl soft reboot only. Systemctl reboot will first determine what has to be done, and then it will trigger the soft reboot.
We may need to follow up then, yeah.
The system D's decision is before the service would actually trigger. That's the basics.
One quick... Oh, sorry, go ahead. Okay, the transactional updates apply. We had a discussion also on PM, because mm-hmm. I heard about this before. Will there be, or is there already a kind of a switch which says this should not never be used, so that a administrator globally can decide, I always want to use truly transactional updates without the kind of intermediate stage of transactional apply, because that might be needed in some cases.
No, you can't, because an administrator can just turn that switch back on.
That is okay, but if for example, it can be said that globally the switch is applied, that it can be de-applied is no problem. But can this be switched off so that nobody accidentally uses it?
Not so far. I mean, I could just hide it behind the configuration option again.
Okay, we'll open Jira. Thank you.
By the way, really cool. Thank you for actually making that apply happen. One thing that wasn't really clear on the slide, or I think it's implicit that it works, but you can do like chain of these changes, right? You can do apply multiple times after each other.
Of course, you'll get a chain of use amounts then. Yeah. Oh, by the way, if anybody from the kernel team knows how to avoid those chains of use amounts, that would be amazing, because it just looks strange. But apart from that, it's working perfectly fine.
And then the other question, I don't think that I've seen it in SLE Micro 6.0, even as a tech preview. Should we do that? Like, we can open JIRAs.
Should we do what?
Like, we are at RC, right, of SLE Micro.
Yeah.
We can still add it as a tech preview, because I know it's not there yet.
It is added in...
In 6.0?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Sorry, it was the wrong term. I used SLE Micro instead of SLE Micro.
Yeah. But thank you. That helps. I've already checked Kimmy. Thank you.
So I know that a lot of these developments are happening on the Micro OS side. And something I constantly miss is when a new feature is added. Where exactly can I see or follow more or less the developments that are coming from?
First of all, that's the reason why I'm having the talks all the time. The mm-hmm. problem is a bit, my last talk was at FOSDEM, so it was a completely different conference.
Yes.
But we also have the news file. I'll write all changes in there, and mm-hmm. the most important ones are on the top.
Okay,
in the repository.
Okay, cool. Thanks.
I'll order them by importance, what I think is important for people.
Why we don't mark packages save for transactional apply? So, for example, if I'm using SLE Micro or whatever micro thingy, I'm always missing a proper editor. And I know I can install and apply it because it won't change the system.
Exactly.
And we know many packages like TCP dump or whatever of you want in, where I know, okay, they are safe to apply. Why we don't make this on package level and say, okay, there are a bunch of packages where we know they are safe to apply.
Because we still want... That's why it's controversial, because we want to preserve that transactional part. By doing an apply, you're basically circumventing that. It's just a convenience tool, but we certainly don't want that by default.
Okay, that is granted, but just say, okay, if a package has some systemd services file in it, then you say an extra warning which tells you, if you apply, hell will come down to you, but not for Vim. Why not something like this?
I mean, you have to know that apply exists anyway.
Okay.
Then you know that you can just do an apply after a Vim installation. I think it's dangerous to do an auto detection which packages may use apply directly, which not, because as a user, I have no idea anymore, will that be automatically applied? Won't it be automatically applied? It has to be some kind of consistency, in my opinion.
Yeah. Yeah. For the overlay FS tree, which you mentioned, which adds to your confusion, would it help if we have an option like a percolate or a merge, which would merge to layers altogether? So that the next time you mount, it's lesser number of directories you need to specify in the configuration. And if yes, when do you decide that it's okay to merge to?
Merging overlays itself probably won't help, because every layer has a dedicated reason to be there. what will currently be done is the state of the current -2 snapshot will be synced into the snapshot via rsync. I have several ideas. May I approach you later? Especially because I think, oh no, we are not over time yet. Any other questions? If not, then thanks a lot for listening to the talk.